Hi, this is Adam, a design specialist with UC Berkeley's Makerspace at Jacobs Hall, and this video is meant to introduce MakerPass holders to our Woodshop. It also serves as prerequisite material to our in-person hands-on Woodshop training, through which students gain access to the five machines behind me: the table saw, compound reciprocating miter saw, vertical band saw, drill press, and the combination belt and disc sander. After watching this video, you'll join a staff member for in-person training, after which you'll be able to use this equipment to fabricate to your heart's content, provided that your heart's content occurs during our open hours and that it doesn't jeopardize your safety or the safety of those around you. Speaking of jeopardizing your safety and the safety of those around you, let's begin with the most important material covered in this virtual hands-on training: safety. The machines in this space have been grouped together and secured by MakerPass access for a reason. They all generate dangerous amounts of rotational inertia that can lead to serious injury. We always have a staff member present in the space during open hours, and if a staff member is absent, the machines will be locked. If you are observed to be disregarding our safety standards, your access will be revoked. We have several general rules for the space. When crossing into the woodshop, you must badge in using our MakerPass system. While in the woodshop, you must wear safety glasses at all times. Safety glasses can be found hanging on the wooden dowels in rooms 110 and 120. We also have safety glasses available for purchase if you'd like to own your own. If you have long hair, it must be tied back, and we have hair ties available in the space in case you forget your own. Short sleeves are required in the space, and if you have any kind of loose or hanging jewelry, it must be set aside. Gloves are also prohibited when using these machines. The rationale here is, of course, that if clothing or hair becomes entangled in any of these machines, you could be pulled in. These machines spin at thousands of rotations per minute, speeds at which even the fastest reaction times are entirely meaningless. And so it is of crucial importance that we position ourselves to avoid all potential for entanglement. Each machine has its own individual safety guidelines, so let's go one by one. This is our table saw, outfitted with a 10-inch blade that can be changed for cutting different materials, usually woods and plastics.
We've removed the mandatory blade guard from some demonstration shots in this video to improve visibility, but please note that the guard must stay on whenever the saw is in use. See a design specialist if the presence of the guard makes your cut impossible.
The table has a 32-inch span when using the rip fence, and a built-in measuring tape on which the fence can be locked. We always say that these built-in guides are accurate but not precise. Make sure to check your work with a tape measure or calipers before making a cut. This saw is named after its built-in safety feature, the saw stop. The blade is able to sense the conductivity or capacitance of the material it comes into contact with, and when it touches something it's not expecting, it fires an aluminum blank into the blade, stopping it in about 5 milliseconds, destroying both the blank and the blade. This adds a level of safety to the machine, but you must still exercise extreme caution around it and behave as you would around any cutting instrument that's flying at more than 2,000 inches per second, with focus and intentionality. This is what the blade looks like after an encounter with a saw stop. We've had this happen a few times at Jacobs, once because the blade came into contact with a staple that was left in the piece of found lumber, once because a student cut wood that was damp on the inside, and once because the plastic that was being cut was coated in a thin mirrored film, which turned out to be conductive. Remember, anything conductive, like metal or water, will trigger the cartridge to activate. The height of the blade is adjusted by rotating this wheel and should be locked once your goal height is reached. The angle of the blade can similarly be adjusted on the right side of the machine. The blade should stick out only around 1/8 of an inch higher than your material. Keeping the angle at which the individual teeth shave away material shallow can make your cuts cleaner and prevent unnecessary blade stick out that can be a hazard while cutting. To make your cut, you can use several tools that we have available. You can use the fence to make long cuts or rip cuts, the miter gauge located below the machine for cross cuts, miter cuts, or compound miter cuts, or the miter sled for an extra level of control and safety. There are almost no circumstances when using the miter gauge and the fence at the same time is advisable. Constraining your piece along three edges will readily cause your material to bind, potentially resulting in kickback. Kickback is when potential energy builds up in either the blade or your material, and that energy is released when your piece is thrown, usually in the direction of the blade's spin, at extremely high speeds. For this reason, we also recommend you take cuts from one side of the blade or the other and never stand directly behind your cut. You'll usually want to position yourself on the left side of the machine when possible for its ready access to the machine's off switch. But the most important aspect of positioning is comfort. You never want to stand in a way that makes you feel unbalanced or like you're reaching over the blade during a cut. If you have questions about what kind of cut setup makes the most sense for your project, please talk it through with a member of our design staff. The on-off switch is lifted out to start the blade spinning and pushed in to stop the machine. The blade takes a few seconds to slow down to a stop, so don't get complacent until the machine comes to complete rest. A red light next to the switch indicates that either something is touching the blade or that the blade or saw stop cartridge has been installed improperly. See design staff if the red light persists. A blinking green light means the blade is still coming to a stop or otherwise not quite ready to activate. A green light means the machine is ready to cut. After I've made triple sure that there's nothing about my person that could become entangled in the blade, and that I'm wearing safety glasses, and that design staff are in the area, and that I'm sure of my plan for my material, I'm ready to make my cut. Activate the dust exhaust system using the green button on this hanging key fob. Open the hatch on the tubing that extends under the table saw, and make sure that other hatches are closed to increase airflow. In this case, we'll make a rip cut of 1 inch. I align the fence and set aside a push stick within easy grabbing distance. A cut this narrow is too small to safely use my hands to guide both sides of the cut. And so I use scrap material or a push stick to support. My right hand supports my stock and feeds it into the blade. Once I can no longer safely push forward on my material with my feeding hand, I grab my nearby push stick and feed it the rest of the way through. I don't stop until my material is completely clear of the machine, and I remember that both sides of the material need to be pushed past the blade since the bridge connecting them will be severed. Remember also to never force material through a cutting blade. If the cut sticks at all, turn the machine off and diagnose the issue. In your planning for a cut, remember to give yourself room on both sides of the machine for where your material will start and where it will end. We have rollers you can position to help support your cut if the material is heavy. And if you're cutting a very big material, please enlist the help of either another trained user or a member of the Jacobs design staff. Also remember that because the blade of the table saw is an eighth of an inch thick, you will lose an eighth of an inch of material for every cut you take. And so need to plan your attack accordingly if material is limited. Once you're finished, lower the blade below the surface of the table and vacuum up and dust in or around the machine to leave it ready for the next user. The sliding compound miter saw, otherwise known as a chop saw, is used for taking smaller cross cuts of your material. This machine can handle pieces of wood that are up to 11 inches wide and up to 3.5 inches thick. Unlike the table saw, this blade doesn't have an included saw stop. Be very careful when making cuts to keep your fingers clear of the engraved inner circles and to go slowly and let the machine do the work. Like I said for the table saw, never force material through a spinning blade. If something gets stuck, turn the machine off and diagnose the problem. You won't save yourself any time by damaging the stock or your person. The same rules apply with this machine. Glasses on, hair back, sleeves short, and never wear gloves. If you arrive at the machine with it in the down and lock position, like this, push down on this handle and pull out on the small red knob to discharge the lock and allow the machine to be lifted. Once you've measured the length you wish to cut, mark your part with a pencil and square it up to the machine. Your material must always be pushed back against the back fence, or else the rotating blade will perform this operation for you, potentially clamping your fingers in the process. If you're cutting a single miter, you can rotate this knob counterclockwise to unlock the machine's swivel, depress that switch, and position the blade according to the angle you wish to cut. Remember to return it to the home position and lock the knob when finished. Turn on the exhaust and open the lever-operated valve. The motor is activated by pulling in on the safety switch and then pushing the trigger. Be aware that there will be a significant kickback to the machine as it spins up and proceed slowly down through your material until you bottom out. There are two other functionalities to this machine that could prove useful for you. This blade can be pulled outwards to make wider cuts. If this makes sense for your cut, unlock this function by flipping this red switch. Pull the machine out, spin up the blade, descend into your material, and push it slowly back until you reach the backstop. Stop cutting and return the blade to its home position. When you're not using the reciprocating functionality, please remember to relock the switch so the next person to use the machine isn't surprised when a spinning blade comes out towards them instead of down into their work. Once finished, turn off the exhaust, vacuum up any stray dust, and return the machine to the prior locked position. If the table saw is used for making straight cuts and removing a lot of material, the bandsaw is used for making curved cuts or cutting through especially thick or unusually shaped materials. The bandsaw is of course named after its manner of cutting, where it uses a band-shaped cutting blade on two rotating wheels to remove material. This machine is really flexible, but perhaps less precise than the reciprocating compound miter saw or the table saw, depending on your skill and whether or not you're using a fence. It can be used to cut woods and some plastics, but we avoid PVC because it tends to melt and gum up the blade. This machine takes some planning if you want to make curved cuts. Make sure that as your material turns, it is able to rotate fully given the machine's 16th inch throat. The blade guard and bearing should be positioned so that they are only around a quarter inch above your stock. You can adjust the height by unscrewing this black knob and rotating this wheel. Once you have it where you want it, lock the placement by gently tightening the black knob. No other levers, wheels, or knobs should be adjusted without consultation with a design specialist. Users are not allowed to change the blade of the vertical bandsaw alone. If for some reason you would like a different blade or you suspect the blade is dull, please ask a design specialist for assistance. Turn on the exhaust. Make sure that the vent leading to the bandsaw is open and that all other vents are closed. Turn on the machine with this green button and make your cut. Hitting the red button will turn off the machine, but importantly will not stop it from spinning. The blade is still incredibly dangerous at this point. Use your foot to depress this brake pedal until the machine comes to a full stop. Vacuum up any dust and clean the space to leave it ready for the next user. The drill press here is used for making controlled holes in your stock material. We have a number of types of drill bit, standard bits in imperial sizes, Forstner bits used for making wide flat holes, spade bits for cutting large rough holes, and hole saw bits for cutting very large plugs out of your material. As with all other equipment in the space, the highest priority here is safety. The highest risk with this machine is entanglement. So once again, check your person for anything that could get caught in the rotating spindle. The machine has no automatic stop function, so be very aware of where the red on-off button is and how it works. Both the height and angle of the drill press table can be adjusted. The height is controlled with this lever in the back. The angle of the bed is controlled by loosening the two knobs underneath the table. Make sure you return all of these angles to zero when you're done to avoid the next user inadvertently drilling angled holes in their material. Use the attached chuck key to open and close the jaws of the chuck. Open them to insert a new bit and then close them by rotating the key firmly. Never start the machine with a chuck key in the chuck as it will spin around wildly and could be thrown from the machine. To prevent leaving it in the machine or losing it, always have it either in the dedicated holster or in your hand, never anywhere else. Once you're ready to drill, arrange any combination of guides and clamps to secure your material. If you work hold using only your hands, you risk your stock helicoptering and causing injury. Drill slowly, and in thicker wood, you can use a pecking method to ensure wood chips are evacuated. And slow down as you approach the back of your material. Use the spoil board material to prevent tear out in the back of your piece, and replace the spoil board if it's too beat up to ensure clean cuts. The drill press also has a light, a laser, an imprecise but useful stopper that can be adjusted so that the drill holes all arrive at the same depth every time. As with the other machines, clean and vacuum your area between uses. The final machine in this collection is one of the most useful, but also one of the most aggressive. These don't actually so much sand as shape your work and will take off material much faster than your typical random orbital hand sander. Because of this level of aggressiveness, they require an enormous amount of caution. If your material gets pulled down between the sanding surface and the metal bed, it can pull your hand into the action of the machine, resulting in serious injury. For that reason, you should always maintain control over the stock you're sanding. The best way to do this for sanding flat material is to keep your piece firmly in contact with the bed at all times. Sanding above the surface of the bed is also a great way to have your material pulled down towards the bed at high speeds, potentially clamping your fingers underneath. It bears mentioning again and again, the risk of entanglement is only as high as you allow it to be. Check your person always for anything that could become caught in rotating machines. The beds of these two sanders can be angled to accommodate different chamfers on your parts, and the sanding disc will take away material in proportion to how far you are from its center of rotation. Closer to the center will result in slower sanding, closer to the edge, faster sanding. Never sand on the rising side of the disc sander, as your material will either be thrown upwards or pulled around the rotation of the abrasive surface and slammed into the table on the opposite side. Operation of this machine is otherwise very simple. The green button is on and the red button is off. Again, take care while the motor is slowing down because the machine is still dangerous and active during this time. With this machine, it is especially important to run ventilation. Make sure that the exhaust is on and that the exhaust port is open between uses. Also be aware at all times that the disc sander and belt sander run on the same motor. And when one is on, the other is on. If there is someone standing nearby, warn them that this will be the case so that they can stand clear and never store parts or stock material on either bed. We have a number of other hand-operated tools in the drawers facing into the main space. Routers, a staple gun, a biscuit joiner, a track saw, chisels, hand planes, sanding materials, and other miscellaneous equipment. Some of it is unlocked, some of it is locked up and open to users with Woodshop training. If you're interested in using any of these tools, let a design specialist know and we will make arrangements for it. Thanks for your attention to all of this content. If you have any questions, feel free to ask them in the comments below. Check out our online module on B-courses or reach out to a design specialist for clarification. At this point, you're ready for hands-on training. Please see our website linked below on instructions for next steps. And really looking forward to seeing everything you build here in the Jacobs Makerspace Woodshop.